Dr. Kurian's birth anniversary as National Milk Day and pays its respect to the man who embodied commitment, professionalism, and dedication to the cause of rural upliftment and development. Dr. Varghese Kurian Memorial Lecture over the years have given us an opportunity to pay homage to Dr. Kurian, as well as listen to the views of and perspective of some of the eminent persons and scholars in the country. We feel really privileged that Dr. Varghese Kurian Memorial Lecture have been delivered in past by Professor M.S. Swaminathan, Professor V.S. Vyas, Professor Raghuram Rajan, Dr. Arvind, Sri Amitabh Kant, Sri Vikram Singh Mehta, Professor Ramesh Chand, Dr. Prem Sankar Goel, Dr. Krishnamurti Subramanyam. Today we are truly honored to have Mr. Myra, Chairman HelpAge International, to speak on this occasion. Mr. Myra is one of the foremost experts on corporate governance, management consultancy, and policy in the world. He is former member of the Erstwhile Planning Commission of India. He is also the former chairman of Boston Consulting Group, India, a thought leader on subjects of leadership and institutional transformation in the private, public, and social sector. He has written several books on institutional transformation. Earlier, he had worked with the Tata Group in India for 25 years and for another 10 years with Arthur D. Little Industry and Innovation Associates in the USA. Presently, he is the chairman of HelpAge International and an advisor to several civil society networks. Now I have the pleasure in inviting Mr. Arun Myra to deliver the 10th Dr. Varghese Kurian Memorial Lecture. Thank you very much.
Professor Dash, thank you very much for the invitation to me to speak here today, and also for the introduction. Nirmala, Siddharth, Dr. Sodhi, Shambhu Prasadji, and the academics, and the teachers, and the future of India, the young leaders of India here today. I'm here to commemorate a great nation builder, Dr. Varghese Kurian, on his 100th birth anniversary at the Institute of Rural Management in Anand, and here in the NDDP, the institute which he had founded. Dr. Kurian's autobiography, I Too Had a Dream, begins with a letter to his grandson. Siddharth, stand up. In which Dr. Kurian writes, I started my working life soon after our country became independent. The noblest task in those days was to contribute in whatever way we could towards the building an India of our dreams. A nation where our people would not only hold their heads high in freedom, but would be free from hunger and poverty. A nation where our people could live with equal respect and love for one another. Now, how can I honor this great man today? I honor him along with all of us assembled here by affirming that Dr. Kurian's dream is our dream too for our country, and by committing to follow the path he showed us to realize it. India set out on 15th August 1947 towards its tryst with destiny in Jawaharlal Nehru's memorial words. But we have miles to go to reach it. We must continue to follow a path Dr. Kurian laid out in his remarkable life. Now let me step back to look at the big picture, at how our country and the world are progressing. There are four very visible problems. The first is the slow suffocation of our own natural environment that we human beings are causing by our pursuit of economic progress. Climate change, carbon in the air, is now attracting everyone's attention, and water under the ground, which is disappearing in our country, is at long last also appearing alongside the problem of the carbon in the intellectual discourse. It was always visible to people on the ground in our country, in India, that water is what they depend upon, and it's disappearing. As well as between the water underground and the air above, the soil, the quality of it, is so rapidly deteriorating in our own country by the impact of our means of progress, of creating more productivity in agriculture. Our country, with 14% or something of the population of the world, has only 3% or less of the arable land in the world. So we depend on the quality of our land. Mrs. Vijayanand, acknowledging you here today and learning from your husband today again about how the earth nurtures us, the very soil nurtures everything, and we are destroying it faster than perhaps anybody is doing anywhere else in the world. Similarly, we have only 4% or less of the freshwater resources of the world, including what is underground, the aquifers, and we are 14% of the population of the world, and we are destroying our aquifers and our freshwater resources faster than anybody else is. Second bundle of problems is about to do with the economy. Not enough jobs being generated in our country, jobs which provide reasonable incomes, sustainable incomes, and through dignified work. Real wages have been declining for the last many years, and very rapidly through the last 2 years of the pandemic. Real wages means what your wage can buy you. India, though it's had very fast growth rates during the last 20 years, for many years, has the lowest employment elasticity with growth of any economy in the world. Employment elasticity said, for every unit of GDP growth, how many good jobs do you generate? India generates the least number of good jobs per unit of GDP growth. A country which has the largest number of young people in the world, our potential for being a great, great, respected force in the world. How are they going to earn? What are we doing in terms of creating opportunities for all young people in the villages and those from our cities to earn with dignity and earn enough and be sure that they are learning to be able to continue earning as they go? The third set of problems is the inequality between those who have and are getting even more and those who don't have enough and are finding it harder to have even that. The number of billionaires is being tracked and celebrated, and we say that, well, India's arriving as being one of the good economies of the world because of the number of unicorns that we are producing. Now, what is a unicorn? A unicorn is a person or an enterprise which produces a lot of notional wealth, valuations, the benefit of which go to just a few people. Does it have any real impact on creating incomes for people on the ground? No, so. And during the pandemic, our stock markets have soared. They've beaten records while people have been losing jobs and lives and livelihoods in millions on the ground. The fourth bundle of problems is the bundle of problems to do with power, the politics of power. Who calls the shots and says, this is the solution? These are the regulations that are good for everybody. Who fixes the rules of the economy? And that's why we've got to come down to the people who are most needing of growth and opportunities and who perceive most of all the restrictions that the present system is causing for them. They should be shaping the rules of the economy, but it's not their voices that are heard in shaping the direction of the economy. So, four large sets of problems, and they interact with each other. It was said in 1990-91, after the fall of the Berlin Wall, that history had ended, according to Francis Fukuyama, a very famous political scientist. And the reason he said was this, that there were two large ideologies that were wanting to prove to the world that they are the solution to the world. One of them is democracy, electoral democracy, and the other is free market capitalism. But there was an opposition to these two forces from very largely the Soviet Union, which didn't believe in electoral democracy and neither in free market capitalism. And with the collapse of the Soviet Union, Francis Fukuyama said that forever now it has been proven that only two forces, two ideologies will now reign, that is electoral democracies as well as free market capitalism. End of history of ideology. No need to study political economics anymore. However, what we are experiencing in the last decade is the conflict between those two victors of that Cold War. Democracy is fighting capitalism, and capitalism is being shaken by the challenge from democracy, from people's movements, the bastions of economic power are being challenged. By them, they are being challenged. So history carries on, and the history has yet to be written. You shall make the history, and some of you shall write the history. You shall write the history too, and learn a new history of combining these two forces. Now there's something contradictory in these two forces. The force of capitalism is based on rights, property rights. It is right that if you own something, you should have the full rights to protect it and to use it, and others should be prevented from taking away your property rights. Yes, it's very right. And onto this system, therefore, that those who own more of something must have a greater say in how it's used. So therefore, in corporate governance, those who own 1 million shares must have 1 million votes, and anybody, small shareholders, owns 1 share should have only 1 vote. It's fair, isn't it? A person owns more should have a greater say. Human rights says that every human being has a beating heart, whether it's a man, a woman, old, young, poor, rich, has an equal vote. Whether a person owns anything or everything, the vote is the same. So how do you take decisions? How do you govern together democratically a system where there are two opposing principles of rights that are prevailing? So I leave you with this question, but this question is a very relevant question here when we are celebrating Dr. Kurien's 100th anniversary, because the cooperative movement is a movement which says methods of governance in which the rights of every person are equal. Yes, and we have to learn those methods of governance and apply them on larger scales. The two other forces that have appeared more recently, this capitalism and democracy have been contending now for over 100 years very visibly. The two other forces, one of them is digital technologies, very new, 15 years. Digital technologies, and they are spreading everywhere, and they can be used for creating economic enterprises, and they could be used also in public discourse, but they are polluting the public discourse. They're causing more divisions, more hate, more very shallow knowledge and wrong knowledge being distributed around the world. But it's there, you can't shut it back into a bottle, this force. It's the third force. The fourth comes to be the earth itself. It's finally, we are hearing it. It says, I'm not going to carry on supporting you the way you've been going on. Think about it. Think about it. So here these four forces have come together and creating the conditions in which we are living, and which if we do not take note of and do something about, life, as we say, for our children and grandchildren will be quite miserable. Now I want to right away say here that we, myself, not yourself, but older people, what we learned, and with good intentions, we have done and taught, has been the problem. So solutions are going to need to be new solutions, and you, young people, therefore, and we also, must open our minds to learn a new way of nurturing the world such that every human being finds themselves treated with dignity, a sense of at least have an equal opportunity, whether I make it or not, depends on my own effort. But there are no invisible barriers to my progress. That's the world we have to find ways to create together. The concept of a circular economy, we've been hearing a lot, and especially when you talk about the environment, yes, things must continue to circulate. Nothing should be allowed to accumulate as waste anywhere. Every waste has a use and should soon be, in good time, put back and be part of the system. So the waste is also a resource, as the resource is also a waste. It must circulate. And thus very good things, like the obvious example is plastic. It's a very good invention. Plastic enables you to keep things sanitized. It is very convenient to carry things around. But if the plastic doesn't circulate, change itself, and be circulated back, it chokes up streams, oceans, and prevents the earth from regenerating itself. So this is the concept of circulation in the physical economy. Now I'm going to use the same concept of circulation into the money economy. Now here, this is the pattern that you have enterprises in which there are people working. There are people who own one asset, like one buffalo, a woman does, or two. And it's their assets, their work, that asset, the only asset they have, some people have no money, just apni mehnat. And others who have, as we said, a little cow, a little piece of land, that's all they have with which they can participate in the economy and get money from their little assets, use of assets. Who gets the money made out of this use? So we've designed institutions, and the limited liability company is a great invention. It was one of the first was the East India Company, founded in 1600, in which investors in London were given the protection of limited liability. That is, come investors, put your money into this enterprise, and if there's any risk or any harm, it's only as much money as you put into it that you can be sued for. The rest is yours to continue and put into something else. And of course, we know the consequences of the East India Company on us here in India. It's a good new model of economic governance. But they couldn't care, the board of the East India Company, on how the money was made by Robert Clive and the others who were Warren Hastings out here in India. So long as they made money, what the board was concerned about was the equal, fair distribution amongst the shareholders depending on how much they put in. That's all. And this model of a limited liability company has continued, has become the dominant model of running economies. And even, as we were hearing yesterday, cooperative societies are finding it sometimes easier to be connected with the regular economy if they convert themselves into a company, because then they can be recognized in the stock exchange. So, but then the principle of governance becomes one which is suited to just fairness in the economy with respect to how much you owned. It's no longer fair to society anymore. So workers work, and they produce by their efficiency and dedication, as I saw yesterday in the dairy and in the chocolate factory, which was lovely. Wonderful things which people are buying and paying for, but at least it's different in your case. But in other cases, the surplus that is made by the higher value that the product commands and the larger scale at which it's sold and the efficiency of the workers, that surplus goes to whom? To those people sitting up in London, the equivalent of it, to decide what to do with that surplus and to invest it into another venture financial venture and some derivatives and make even more money out of money for themselves. So we have to say, how can we get that money which is getting stuck up there in the financial system and being used finance for finance back into the hands of the people who actually generated the wealth? At the moment, the circulation is expected to come back from the people who made all the profits, either through taxes, but they say, if you tax us, we have no incentive to make more money. So you have to allow us to make the pie even larger, mostly for ourselves, but the pie even larger, so that there'll be enough to go around. That's not happening. The second is, well, we can ask you to do some CSR. And so we got a law in India that 2% of your profits, now the profit is probably 10% of your revenue maybe, so 0.2% of your revenues you will spend on building a hospital after all that you've done to the water and the soil has caused so much cancer. You build a nice hospital for cancer, you know, harm millions and cure a few, and you are great. CSR. And philanthropy, same idea really, give back. How much? So what is trickling down through taxes, through CSR, and through philanthropy is very small compared to what is flowing up, which is accumulating up there, and that is why the wealth of the wealthy is going larger and larger. The financial sectors of the economy have grown 3 times as large as a proportion of economies than they were in the 1980s, all over the world. So this is like the plastic accumulated over there. And by the way, yes, money became plastic and it's becoming digital, so it's not even real anymore. But this is, we require different economic institutions designed on different principles of equity and governance. And so this is what we must honor of in this place, and Dr. Kurian, that it is the benefit to the people for which we as managers must work. And our ideas of designs must keep at center, what is this design for? What's the purpose of the enterprise? We in India had written into our constitution, 1976, Article 39, which says this, Article 39B, the ownership and control of the material resources of the community are so distributed, the Constitution requires, are so distributed as best to subserve the common good. Article 39C, that the operation of the economic system does not result in the concentration of wealth and the means of production to the common detriment. Now tell me, who can argue against this? Wouldn't you, as a good citizen, as a good human being, say, I think the ownership and control of material resources of the community should be so distributed that they serve the common good? Yeah. And that the operation of the economic system does not result in the concentration of wealth and the means of production to the common detriment. The word introduced in the Constitution was socialism. And people say, oh, India better not be a socialist country, to remain a capitalist country. Can't capitalism be like this? Fine, now the institution means, and some are here, and to follow those, to make that the way more things are done and perhaps everything is done. When Dr. Brezhnev, who was the president of the Soviet Union, visited India in 1980, he visited here, and he wanted to specially ask that he wants to meet Dr. Kurian. And so the government of India arranged for him to come here and to see Anand and to meet with, you might have remembered that, Dr. Kurian. And I read this in a book written by Madhu Bahaduri of the Indian Foreign Service, who was a young officer asked to accompany Brezhnev to this. And she records that, and her book is called Lived Stories, President Brezhnev asked Dr. Kurian if he thought India had the time to develop slowly on the lines of Amul's success. Dr. Kurian answered that he knew of no better model than that of involving people as stakeholders in development, like in a cooperative. Now, Gandhiji did not like the Soviet Union, and Gandhiji did not like shareholder capitalism. And his reasons were the same reason he didn't like either. He said in both systems, the workers do the work, and some people up there, they get the surplus and decide what to do with it. In one case, it's some bureaucrats in the public sector, in the government. The worker gets a fair wage, hopefully. And certainly in the Soviet system, they ensured that the wages were fair and the working conditions were good. But as he said, he hated that system nevertheless, because the workers did not have control over creation of their own wealth. And with wealth, as Gandhiji said, you get political power. Those who have nothing hardly count. Hardly count. And he, of course, had the same problem with capitalism. He said, I'm a capitalist. I want people to do things efficiently, to produce a surplus. But you have to do it as a trustee of the people and the trustee of society. Means, who do you account to? Again, Dr. Kurian taught us the way. So here I am, here in the nursery of, it's not the only nursery, but it's probably the biggest nursery of this idea, to say, let's learn from the nurseries quite often and not from the old. Yes. What shall we learn from here? We need to develop new forms of economic enterprises as an alternative to shareholder control for shareholder benefit enterprises. Irma, Dr. Kurian, the founder, he had some things to say here, and I found a bit of the history of Irma sent to by one of his first students, Sriram, who sent me, or Shitmar, I forget which one of them. In the last 2 days, they've been delighted that I'm coming here for a good education. And so they've sent me some papers at the time of the founding of Irma. And in a seminal paper by Dr. Michael Halsey, who was then an FAO advisor with the National Dairy Development Board, he wrote in this paper called A New Institute of Rural Management and a New Development Discipline. He said the rural manager's task consists of dealing simultaneously with a series of interacting systems. A, the social and institutional system whereby human beings relate to each other formally and informally. It's a core central part of the system. B, the physical and technical systems whereby man exists within the biosphere and practices agriculture in order to manipulate those systems to human advantage. And C, the economic systems whereby human beings exchange the fruits of each other's labors, and if they are lucky, this is his words to me, save and invest in order to improve their lives in future times. And further, he argued that the practice of rural management requires sensitivity to the priorities and needs of the society, dominated as it is in our country, he didn't say our country, he says dominated as it is by the culture of poverty. In short, what Dr. Halsey said was, rural management requires systems thinking, which is focused on uplifting the wealth and the power of the people at the bottom of the pyramid. So friends, let's step back once again and look at the bigger picture. We need a new framework for global solutions for the environment, for the economy, and for the distribution of political power. We need local solutions to these global systemic problems. The Sustainable Development Goals describe problems to do with the economy, problems to do with inequality, problems to do with the environment, of course, and public health and education, everything. There's so many things that every country has to address, so many different things that every country has to address. Now, these different problems take different shapes in different places. Every state of India has got economic problems, social problems, environmental problems. Every country of the world has environmental problems, social problems, and economic problems. But they're not happening in the same way. And so the solutions to this complex set of problems must be local, related to the shape of the system there. And so to achieve our SDGs, the method is not to have the experts up there telling us environmental solutions as well as public health solutions separately. It is in localities, people supported by experts around them, but people taking the charge of themselves and their communities and their environment to ensure that it's good for everyone and sustainable. So local solutions to global systemic problems must be the way forward. All of you can be leaders of change. A question asked earlier this morning at one of the seminars I attended, and I keep getting asked this question about leadership. Yes, to make change in something requires somebody, perhaps many persons, to take the courage to step out of the way things are being done, to start doing things in a new way, to take a risk, experiment, but do things differently, because if we keep doing things the same way, we're going to keep having the same set of conditions. So leadership is about caring for something which is not here but which you want, and saying, I will take steps towards making something new happen. And any one of us can do that wherever we are, in whatever circumstances we are. So I believe that the change in India is going to be, and is coming about actually, by small people. And I'm happy to see more and more that they're mostly women, many women, who are taking responsibility for their local conditions, their sisters, their families, their environment. And my goodness, with very little resource, they make change happen, which is good for everybody. And so this model of fireflies, these are leaders. They have a very little light, and it's their own light. Okay? But they rise up with that light, and they create hope and more light around themselves. And when many rise together, a swarm of Jugnu fireflies, the darkness turns to light. So you don't have to wait till you become the CEO. Don't even bother to look for an organization which to be a CEO, because maybe we need less organizations which they are CEOs, but they're community organizations which are self-governed with respect for each other, which, yes, somebody who's given charge on behalf of the others, like Dr. Kurin said he had, to ensure that it's well managed and governed, but not for benefit for oneself. Yes, but it's for everyone who's putting the efforts into the organization. We need every level in the system, the local level, the district level, the state level, the national level, the international level, to have a new scorecard. Every level must say, I'm going to judge our well-being by, are we environmentally sustainable? Are we economically fair? Are we socially fair and respectful about each other? Every level. And we are not good unless we are good in all these respects. So we need new scorecards instead of GDP. We need a broader set of measures. Every company needs, more than its profits and its turnover, a broader set of measures. And every city is to start measuring itself. Right? What quality of city are we? What quality of community are we? So new scorecards at all levels as our vision, and we measure ourselves against the progress that we make with respect to everything simultaneously. What must you learn to be a systems leader? Not the chief of an organization, but a systems leader. And every firefly Jugnu is a systems leader. She and he are facilitators of dramatic transformation in a system. They're systems leaders, catalysts of change in the system. Three orientations are required, and each orientation goes with a discipline. Three orientations, three disciplines. The first is systems being. We must realize we could be having like Bezos on 200 billion notional wealth somewhere, but we're a very small part of a very rich, complex system. Be humble. That system has given you life. And if the system is not healthy, no matter how rich you are, you won't have life here. Of course, many of them are now trying to get rockets to go and try and create some sort of life on Mars. And if they take the same ideas of how they run the place here, they'll destroy whatever they may be on Mars also. So be very humble. This is all we have. And it has given us life. It's nurturing us. And we will nurture it. And in systems being, it is also recognizing that I'm not superior to anyone else. The simple woman on the farm has as much wisdom, as much courage, more, I would say, both of wisdom and courage than I have. And so respect and dignity to be given, and not arrogance in oneself. The system's being. The second, well, the discipline here is ethical reasoning. So going into management schools particularly, I find I have to keep reminding them that ask always, what you do, who will it be good for? Gandhiji's Anantodaya. When you take any decision, policy or management, please think of the poorest person you can and say, how would my decision today improve the life today or tomorrow of the poorest person that I can think about? So ethical reasoning for systems being. The second is systems acting, learning to cooperate rather than to compete. Economics in the last century has been driven too much with these false notions that human beings are purely self-interested and rational, and that some invisible hand, by combining the competitive actions of lots of people, creates goodness for everybody. It's not working like that and cannot work like that. So cooperation with others to be able to maintain a world which is good for all of us together. For cooperation with others, I've got to learn to let go of my ego. And I'd say, candidly, that in the civil society sector, there's as much ego amongst the leaders of organization as there is. There's probably less in government. It's more in the corporate sector and the civil society. Mera hai. At least in government, he says, meri position ka hai. But ye to me. And civil society organizations don't cooperate with each other very well, therefore. Whose brand is it, and who's going to get the benefit and recognition for it, and so also in competition in corporations. So let go your ego and support the others around you. The third orientation is systems thinking, which I guess you already understood is necessary. You can't be looking at only one part of a system and being the expert in how to improve it, whether it's the environment, or whether it is the economy, or any one thing like public health. You have to consider that many things affect what you're interested in, and what you do affects everything else. So learn to think of and see the whole system as a picture in your mind to see how it might be operating. So for this, you need curiosity and a desire to keep understanding different things. And this is what keeps one young. Find something which looks strange to you, which seems wrong to you. It seems wrong to you because you don't know anything about it, whereas you feel an expert in something which is more important. But that's the trigger for learning. As soon as something feels strange or wrong to you, say, I've been given life. Now I can explore something new and continue to live. So systems thinking, the discipline is the desire to keep learning, to be curious, and to have humility again. But I don't know everything. There's still so much to learn. So three disciplines and three orientations: systems thinking, systems acting, and systems being. And what the world needs most of all, and I'll end with this, is everyone learning to listen deeply to people not like us. Echoing almost Dr. Kurian's words, or rather it's the other way around, because Gurudev Tagore was born long before. And Gurudev Tagore wrote in Gitanjali, for which he got the Nobel Prize over 100 years ago. And he said in Gitanjali, where the mind is held high, every head is held high, and no mind is with fear, where the world has not been broken up into fragments by narrow domestic walls. And as I said, that we, through the internet and even otherwise, have divided ourselves into fragments amongst people who we like and people we don't like, people who are like us and people who are not like us. And we don't listen to people who we don't like and people who we think are not like us. And we must learn to listen deeply, especially to people not like us. So my poem, if you'll allow me, I'm not a poet really, but it's a poem. It's called Listening. And this is the poem with which I opened my book, Listening for Well-Being, Conversations with People Not Like Us, for which I'm ever grateful to His Holiness the Dalai Lama for writing the foreword to that book. It says, "It is time to press the pause button, put our smartphones on silent, shut out the tweets, trolls, and sound bites, and stop the windmills in our minds. It's time to listen. To listen to the whispers in the trees and to the caring in our hearts. And most of all, to the voices of people not like us. Then we will learn and find solutions." Then we will learn and find solutions for living together on our shared earth. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for delivering an enriching and insightful lecture that I'm sure will inspire not only those who are here, but your words will inspire hundreds and thousands who will do so for years to come and will be much helpful in their endeavors of nation building. I now invite Ms. Nirmala Kurian on stage to present a copy of her book, The Utterly Butterly Milkman, to Sri Arun Myra. Please, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. I now invite Professor C. Shambhu Prasad to offer a vote of thanks. Please, sir.
We have time for a couple of questions, and we would be very happy to have our young minds pose a question or two to our distinguished speaker. If our volunteers have the mics and if any of you can raise your hands. Yeah, otherwise you can run down here, Prashant. Or can you speak loudly? We don't have a mic. Yeah. Just hold on, I think the mic is reaching you. You can run halfway.
Yeah. Coming to the systems thinking part of things, from the time we have come for an MBA here, and I think this is true with all the MBAs around India, we are being trained to run in a rat race, as far as I have observed. Whatever we have seen all over India, this is the same case, because we are time bound, we have schedules to run behind. There's no time for free thinking. Few of my colleagues also were talking about this. When the term 3 ends, term 4 starts the next day. So I have no time to think about what happened in the term 3. So If I don't have time to recall what has happened in the earlier term, so how will I even comprehend systems thinking? How will I know to think broadly? I am just running in a tunnel. I'm running behind my placement. So I just wanted to know.
Yes. Let's take another question and then Prashant, you. Yes. I don't. Okay. Because he's asked, you can see such a popular question. Everyone's answer to this question. You know, Prashant, I'm going to, if you don't mind, tell you a little story. This is in 2005 or 6, when the United Nations Global Compact, which is a voluntary organization, is the only United Nations organization which is run by the private sector. And it was created by Kofi Annan to tell the private sector that you must also take responsibility and decide how you're going to do it for the condition of the world, not be told by the governments what you're going to do. So the United Nations Global Compact, and I was a senior advisor in the board of the Global Compact, they felt that the 30 CEOs who were from the world on the board said, you know, the students that we get from the management schools, who are after all the people whose ideas are we are using, and so unless the management schools create more responsible leaders, how can our corporations become more responsible? So they were throwing the problem to say the management schools are the problem. They are causing us the problem. So what the Global Compact did was it invited PRIME, which is the Principles for Responsible Management Education. It's a global network of business schools around the world. There's some 2,000-3,000 schools who are members, for a joint conference in Cleveland, and in which conference, and this is an interesting part, they were through that time also the internet was possible, there were students participating from schools all over the world, business schools and development schools around the world, and deans, as well as there were 1,000 people in the hall, deans as well as these business leaders, 700-800 people in the hall. And the point came, you see, when the big speeches are made and discussions, that it is this problem, that is the management schools, unless they develop new sorts of leaders, how can the world change? So time was called out to say this is becoming very divisive. Let's take a smaller group of business leaders. So 5 or 10 were chosen who were like the senior most, and 10 or 15 of the deans of the management schools, presidents of the management schools. And let's have a smaller, calmer dialogue between you. Okay, how can you together change the world? And I was invited to facilitate that discussion with Professor C.K. Prahlad. And this is what happened. The leaders of the business school, the businesses, the senior most leaders, said that, you know, you business schools should stop teaching finance and marketing. Why? Because through finance, we are learning just to measure the financial benefits to ourselves and our shareholders, so stop it. And marketing, we are selling people stuff to increase our revenues and actually spoiling their lives and the world. So stop teaching finance and marketing and teach social science and human management. Okay? The business schools responded to said, the highest salaries that you offer are to students in finance and marketing. And by the way, they said, look, we are also in the background of business. You may call us an education institution, but we've got to be economically viable also. So we, to attract people, to pay our fees, we have to sort of assure them that they'll get a higher salary afterwards. So if you please stop giving high salaries to marketing and finance and give higher salaries to students of Armal, I'm saying, you will get the right sort of education. But the point comes this. Both sides were saying the other side is responsible to make the change, not us. Now, leadership is doing the taking the first steps towards something that you deeply care about and in ways that others will then follow. If you are going to wait for someone else to take the first steps to prove that there is a way and there's less risk and then follow that path, then you're not a leader. So I humbly say, Dr. Kurin is the leader and I'm the follower. He took those risks, but I can see there's a way. But it comes to that for leadership, you must care for something and say, whatever I do is towards what I really deeply care about. And I have been finding, as we found in that discussion, that asking both the deans as well as the business leaders, what do you deeply care about? And since they all had assembled to say they deeply care about inclusion in society and the sustainability of the environment, then what are you going to do which is different to what is being done so that you can be the leader of the change, an example of the change? And you have to do it in a way that others wish to follow you, and that is important. They will wish to follow you if they also are given a role in determining the way it's going and given credit for it also. If by following you, you are going to become glorified as an even greater, more respected leader. I mean, they're human beings. They also want respect and dignity and recognition. Why would they follow you, right? So humility in doing that. So let me say, Gandhiji is a great firefly. And Gandhiji is a great expression of this definition of leadership, taking the first steps towards what you deeply care about, not waiting for anyone. He took steps to do things which seemed with the resources that he had and we had impossible. I will not use violence, and of course he certainly didn't have money to line up people to come to his meetings and to follow. When he went on the Dandi March, he had a danda. It wasn't to beat the people who didn't follow. It was to support his old body. He didn't have any money to tell them, as I said, to come along and, you know, be food for you on the way. Look out for themselves. But why were they following? Because what he cared about, they knew was what mattered to them. He had listened to them. He really deeply listened. Gandhiji and they cared for the same goodness for the world. So yes, changing the education institution like we were talking, Dr. Dash, just before this. I mean, he's running an institution here and he has to also live in the world. But you can't accept it. You can't accept it. And I think, from what I've encountered with you, you are doing your best to try and make a change. Yes? And I know it's hard because you also need support. You need students to come here who say, I'm not going to be insisting that you're going to help me get a job with Infosys. Because you have students here who had jobs in Infosys and say, I want something different. So there's a possibility here, yes, of you being, and you are perhaps, but being much more visible to others as a role model of a new institution. But this feedback being given to you, you're not giving enough time.
Okay. Any other questions?
There's a lady there, a girl there.
So my question is, so you mentioned about the four forces of living, capitalism, digital technology, earth, and democracy. So how can I as an individual balance between these four forces?
That's exactly the point. Just think in your own little life, let's start with that. Yeah? Democracy means that you give respect to other people's views as equal to yours, whether there's a domestic help in your house, as a dignity to the person for their views. Yeah? Could be your neighbors, older, younger. They may not have the same religion. So you would be, that's democracy, genuine democracy. Respecting others, that they have an equal right to exist and to have a view. Do you practice that every day? And which is why I said to about reach out and start listening to people who you have been avoiding listening to for some reason or the other. One. Number two, when you talk about capitalism, yes, you need to earn also. But are you earning just to make yourself even wealthier, to look even wealthier compared to your peers? The wealth should be, like Gandhiji said, enough to help you live, by your standards, a decent, good life. But not to have more than others to say, look, I have more than you. So this is talking responsible capitalism. The third as you mentioned, is about the environment, which is in everybody's air. In your daily acts, are you doing what you can responsibly do, given what's available to you? One is not asking you to stop eating some foods altogether, because you may have no choice at that moment but to eat some foods, while being conscious that I'll eat less of these because they damage the system much more as they're grown than others. But take responsibility while taking responsibility for the environment. So we've got democracy, we've got capitalism, and we've got here we're taking care of the environment. The last one about the media, put off your cell phone sometimes. Yes, your smartphone. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. And of course, we could go on, but I think there are lots of events, and we may also have an opportunity to interact with Sri Arun Mehra informally. It's my pleasure to propose a vote of thanks. I'd like to first deeply thank Sri Arun Mehra for accepting our invitation. Given that he does not travel as much, he cared to come to Irma, and he deeply cared for Dr. Kurian as well. And more importantly, he chose to come and spend time with us. And we are deeply touched by the fact that you came one day earlier and you're staying back for some more time. And I think from what I hear about Dr. Kurian, he was able to get even the World Bank president to come and do that. And without people coming and spending time and having these critical conversations you've had with us, we would have been much poorer. So we deeply value your time and the effort you've made to be with us these couple of days, and also spend time with our students, the workshop participants. We had an opportunity to even manage a field visit this morning to the Baikaka Krishi Kendra. So we, on behalf of IRMA, the board of directors, all our sister institutions, our deep gratitude for you, to you for making it to Anand and spending time with us. It's always been a pleasure reading your books. We are more enriched listening to you each time. It strengthens our conviction towards complex adaptive systems thinking, and acting in a way in which we can rebuild the world better together. You've given us enough ideas about the need for a new framework, and also tools that might help us to rethink capitalism, in which we embed equity and governance in our institutional structures. I'd like to thank all our sister institutions, the board of directors, Mrs. Nirmala Kurian, Siddharth, Mrs. Vijay Kumar, and Mr. Sodhi, and many others here, present here, for gracing this occasion. A thanks to NDDB and the whole team that has made it possible for us to have this event in this lovely Tribhuvanadas Patel Auditorium. And all dignitaries present here, our faculty, our staff, our students, for making this event a very memorable one. So you've given us enough ideas to think for the next 10 years and also act along, and we hope to carry on having these critical conversations with you. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, sir. Now I would like to request everyone to please rise for the national anthem. Thank you, everyone. Ladies and gentlemen, that brings us to the end of this event. On this special day, what could be more apt than following the traditional way of celebration? We will now celebrate Dr. Kurian's 100th birth anniversary through a splendid cake-cutting ceremony by Ms. Nirmala Kurian. All are requested to please gather on the central lawns just outside the auditorium for the cake-cutting ceremony, followed by high tea. Please note that after the cake-cutting ceremony and high tea session, a session on experience sharing by Dr. Varghese Kurian is being organized back here in the T.K. Patel Auditorium. I request everyone to please gather here 5 p.m. for the experience sharing session. I request the volunteers to please guide the attendees towards the central lawns. Thank you.